Good morning. Welcome to the online worship service of the Universalist Unitarian Church of Waterville, Maine. My name is Ray Winship, and I will be your worship associate for today. This is the 14th online worship service in the history of our church. The Reverend Al Boyce will be our worship leader. Today's worship service will also feature music from Annabeth Reinders, Harry Veo, and Bill Barnett. Margaret Thomas will read the story for all ages. As you will see, we have assembled the online worship service from video clips that various friends and members of this church have recorded themselves. Thank you to the many members and friends of this church who have helped put together these online services. If you would be interested in making a video of yourself doing a call to worship, chalice lighting, reading, music, or some other part of the service, please email the worship committee at uuworshipcommittee@gmail.com. Thank you. Now on to our announcements. As usual at 11 a.m. today, Sunday, June 21st, 2020, the church will be hosting a virtual coffee hour. The virtual coffee hour will be hosted using Zoom, which many of us are probably familiar with by now. To join this coffee hour, and to find information about how to join the coffee hour, go to our church's website, which is www.uucwaterville.com. There you will find a link to the virtual coffee hour, and you will also find instructions for how to join the coffee hour. As a reminder, Karen Kuziak is willing to offer beginning training for those using Zoom either as a host or a participant. Please contact Karen if you would be interested. Join our church friends for a virtual coffee house each Thursday evening from 6:30 to 8 p.m. Come to sing, play music, read a poem, do a comedy routine, or just to listen and enjoy. Performers of all ages are welcome. Information about how to join should be in the midweek update and is also posted on the homepage www.uucwaterville.com. Just scroll down the page a bit until you get to the coffee house information. If you'd like to perform, please email Harry Veo at veowoods@live.com before the coffee house. Hope to see you there, and as always, BYOC, bring your own coffee. If you have any announcements that you would like to include in these online services, email your announcement to uuworshipcommittee@gmail.com by 5 p.m. on the Thursday before the Sunday service, and we will include your announcement in the online worship service for that Sunday. We are now going to move on to the greeting our neighbors portion of our service, which is a little bit different than how we do it during our in-person worship services. Usually during this portion of our service, we exchange greetings with the people who are sitting near us in the pews. However, as we are watching this online worship service, we may be alone or with family members or with friends or perhaps even in a space with acquaintances or people we don't know. As we watch this online worship service, we can imagine that we are still sitting in virtual pews, together in mind and spirit, if not in body. The purpose of the greeting our neighbors part of our service is to acknowledge people around us who have come to worship together in our church. As we sit in our virtual pews right now, take a moment to think about the other people who you see from time to time during our worship services. Think of someone who you might like to say hello to this morning. You don't have to do it right this moment, but at some point today, get out your cell phone or computer and send that person a text or an email. Or even give them a quick phone call and say something like, "Good morning, I was thinking of you today. I hope you're well and I'm keeping you in my thoughts." Even though we are physically separated right now, we can still acknowledge our fellow riders on this spiritual journey. And now, please prepare yourself for worship as we listen to the prelude. Our chalice lighting this morning is a chalice lighting for challenging times by Lisa Dodge. Why a flaming chalice? The question comes. It's the cup of life we answer, a cup of blessings of overflowing, a cup of water to quench our spirit's thirst, a cup of wine for celebration and dedication, the flame of truth, the fire of purification, oil for anointing, healing, out of chaos, fear, and horror. Thus was the symbol crafted a generation ago. So may it be for us. In these days of uncertainty, sorrow, and rage, and a light to warm our souls and guide us home.
Good morning. My name is Reverend Al Boyce, and I am your minister for the day on this particularly special Sunday, Father's Day. I share opening words this morning written by Calvin Dane entitled, Acknowledgement of Our Limitations. We come seeking ourselves, knowing that we do not live alone, knowing that we cannot fully live if we are for ourselves alone. We come as ordinary people, each with strengths and each with weaknesses, aware of our shortcomings. Our lives set before us many tasks. We are not always equal to them. Too often we fall short of our best expectations of ourselves. We do not know enough. We are not always patient. We fall into anger. We cannot find strength. We do not wait for wisdom. We lack vision. It hurts. It hurts to acknowledge our shortcomings. And yet, here we are, not always perfect, not always wise, but always human, gloriously and miraculously alive and breathing, wondrously and mysteriously human. Ancient reading this morning. There too, Seneca wrote, true happiness is to enjoy the present, without anxious dependence upon the future, not to amuse ourselves with either hopes or fears, but to rest satisfied with what we have, which is sufficient. For he that is so wants nothing. The greatest blessings of humankind are within us and within our reach. A wise man is content with his lot, whatever it may be, without wishing for what he has not. Marcus Tullius Cicero wrote, gratitude is not only the greatest of virtues, but the parent of all others.
Hello. The poem I'm reading today is a poem that was written for the second inaugural of Barack Obama and was read at his inauguration on January 21st, 2013. The poem is titled One Today. One sun rose on us today, kindled over our shores, peeking over the Smokies, greeting the faces of the Great Lakes, spreading a simple truth across the Great Plains, then charging across the Rockies. One light, walking up rooftops, under each one a story, told by our silent gestures moving behind windows. My face, your face, millions of faces in morning mirrors, each one yawning to life, crescendoing into our day. Pencil yellow school buses, the rhythm of traffic lights, fruit stands, apples, limes, and oranges arrayed like rainbows begging our praise. Silver trucks, heavy with oil or paper, bricks or milk, teeming over highways alongside us, on our way to clean tables, read ledgers, or save lives, to teach geometry or ring up groceries as my mother did for 20 years so I could write this poem. All of us, as vital as the one light we move through, the same light on blackboards with lessons for the day, equations to solve, history to question, or atoms imagined, the I have a dream, we keep dreaming. Or the impossible vocabulary of sorrow that won't explain the empty desks of 20 children marked absent today and forever. Many prayers, but one light, breathing color into stained glass windows, life into the faces of bronze statues, warmth onto the steps of our museums and park benches as mothers watch children slide into the day. One ground, our ground, rooting us to every stalk of corn, every head of wheat sown by sweat and hands, hands gleaning coal or planting windmills in deserts and hilltops that keep us warm. Hands digging trenches, routing pipes and cables. Hands as worn as my father's cutting sugarcane, so my brother and I could have books and shoes. The dust of our homes and deserts, cities and plains, mingled by one wind, our breath. Breathe, hear it, through the day's gorgeous din of honking cabs, buses launching down avenues, the symphony of footsteps, guitars, and screeching subways, the unexpected songbird on your clothesline. Hear squeaky playground swings, trains whistling, or whispers across cafe tables. Hear the doors we open for each other all day, saying, hello, shalom, buongiorno, howdy, namaste, or buenos dias. In the language my mother taught me, in every language spoken into one wind, carrying our lives without prejudice, as these words break from my lips. One sky. Since the Appalachians and Sierras claimed their majesty and the Mississippi and Colorado worked their way to the sea, thank the work of our hands, weaving steel into bridges, finishing one more report for the boss on time, stitching another wound or uniform, the first brush stroke on a portrait or the last floor on the Freedom Tower, jutting into a sky that yields to our resilience. One sky, toward which we sometimes lift our eyes, tired from work, some days guessing at the weather of our lives, some days giving thanks for a love that loves you back. Sometimes praising a mother who knew how to give, or forgiving a father who couldn't give what you wanted. We head home through the gloss of rain or weight of snow or the plum blush of dusk, but always home, always under one sky, our sky. And always one moon, like a silent drum tapping on every rooftop and every window of one country, all of us facing the stars. Hope. A new constellation waiting for us to map it, waiting for us to name it together. Let it be so.
Modern reading this morning are the words written by Paul Hawken, environmentalist, social activist, writer, and editor. He wrote this: "When asked if I am a pessimist or an optimist about the future, my answer is always the same. If you look at the science about what is happening on Earth and aren't pessimistic, you don't understand data. But if you meet the people who are working to restore this Earth and the lives of the poor, and you aren't optimistic, you haven't got a pulse. What I see everywhere in the world are ordinary people willing to confront despair, power, and incalculable odds in order to restore some semblance of grace, justice, and beauty to the world." So ends the reading.
Now is the time in our service where we share the joys and concerns that are in our hearts. I've collected these joys and concerns over email today, and will read them in a moment. Before I share the joys and concerns, I want to mention that I will provide details about the joys and concerns. However, this online worship service will be posted online where the general public can view it. Therefore, usually I am omitting people's names and will instead provide only the information about their joy or concern. Those who are familiar with our congregation will likely know who I am talking about, but by omitting people's names, I can also preserve their privacy and confidentiality. Luke has a joy and concern and is given permission to use names. The joy is that Torrin and Emerus have been at Popham Beach with their grandparents since Sunday, and Luke and Crystal have had time of their own in Waterville. It is great to have some time to relax and sleep. Yet when they are gone, we miss them. So I guess that is the concern. Every time I see a pretty flower or a frog or toad, an interesting insect, I think of Emerus, because those are the things that he loves and points out when he sees them. I wonder what he would have said or how he would have reacted in that moment. And I just want to see him and be part of his life. Maybe this is a bit of foreshadowing about what life will be like as the kids get older and more independent. They will be off on their own, and I'll be wondering what they're doing and wishing that I could see their faces. For the joys and concerns which have been expressed, as well as those joys and concerns that lie still unspoken, we offer thoughtful minds, helping hands, and loving hearts.
A meditation for this Father's Day. Mike Johnson wrote it, and it's entitled Fathering Words. I like it. I invite you to relax in a moment, if you wish, with your eyes closed, just listening to this time and of reflection by Mike. Think about the father figure you carry in your heart this Father's Day. I invite you to remember the gifts and the wounds you receive from that person or persons. If any feelings come up, just breathe deeply and honor those feelings as a connection with your own heart. I invite you to listen to some fathering words that we don't hear often enough. I love you just the way you are. I have confidence in you. You can achieve your goals. I will stand behind you. You can depend on me. I am proud of you. Stand up for yourself. Your opinions and feelings are important. I have faith in you. Amen. My sermon theme for this Father's Day is entitled Grace and Gratitude. It was 1979 in the fall, and I had just gone through a devastating time in my life, and it included an ending of my relationship and not seeing my son for a long time and not having a career any longer because I came out as a gay person. And it was a very difficult time for me. I remember going to the Wilbur Theater in Boston, I believe it was October of 1979, feeling really down and a bit lost, although feeling good about being an authentic self. Still, the losses were just so incalculable. And I remember watching the show by Pat Carroll doing a one-woman stand-up of Gertrude Stein's life. And I had never heard of Gertrude Stein, sad to say, until that time. And I remember at some point during the monologue, Pat Carroll just pointed her finger north, way up in the balcony where I was sitting, and said these words, "To survive, you must be flexible." And gosh, I remember at that point, I was feeling this lack of flexibility. I didn't want my life to change so dramatically as it was changing. I felt it was completely out of my control. I feel like I had no power over where my career would go or my relationship of how often I would see my son and just so many unknowns. And that day began the day of beginning to be flexible, to accept life on life's terms. I haven't always done it perfect since then, but it has certainly helped. And a part for me of being flexible is understanding and accepting grace. The grace to be in the moment, as Seneca, our ancient writing, said this morning. Being present today where I am with my feet settled firmly on the earth, not lamenting the past or planning to be better in the future, but fully present for who we are and where we are in life. And for me, on this Father's Day, that's like being present as a dad, and now as a grandfather, and as a spouse, being fully present in this moment despite all that's going on around us that calls for greater involvement of the world, be that protests for racial equality, or be that helping to understand the needs of the medical community and our neighbors during a time of COVID-19, present. And then Cicero added to what Seneca had to say, that ancient of philosophers reminds us that being grateful is the parent of all other virtues. So for me, we are invited to be grateful for what wisdom we do have, even if we feel it's limited, to be grateful for the skills, the gifts, the relationships as they are in this moment. Grateful for clarity of mind and thought, knowing what the right thing to do for us is and having the strength to follow it. Many of you know that I am deeply involved in the movement of moral injury. I'm very passionate about the work, and I represent our Northern New England region of Volunteers America on that topic. And I work with national folks as well as help organize and do convenings across the country, but primarily here in New England. Early in April, perhaps late March, our Vice President of Moral Injury at our national office in Alexandria, Virginia, Rita Brock, and I were talking about the medical community and the moral injury that must be experienced now among them. And we were struggling with what we might do to help before moral injury takes such a deep hold, particularly in the physicians and nursing teams and direct caregivers of those who are living and dying with COVID-19. So as we were talking about it, we decided that we would try to create some webinars on the topic. And our very first webinar, we've done several now, and they are quite successful. We hear. And the first one was on COVID-19 and medical providers. And the themes were moral resiliency during the time of COVID-19 for the medical community. We invited a group of folks from across the country as panelists, people who worked on the front lines to assist and help people either live through, survive, or die from COVID-19 virus. And so we invited the physicians and nursing teams and leaders to share their experience with us so that we might have a better understanding, and maybe through understanding their experiences, help allay some of their experience as far as in-depth spiritual pain goes. We invited Dr. Cinda Rushton to be the responder to the panel, and she did a really incredible job helping us out. I just want to share a little bit about Cinda's experience. She is the Professor of Clinical Ethics at the Berman Institute of Bioethics and the School of Nursing at Johns Hopkins University. Her current scholarship is in the area of distress and suffering of clinicians, the development of resilience based on integrity, respect, truth, and compassion. She responded at one point with the acronym of GRACE as way of members and of the medical teams addressing and supporting each other. One of the questions that we had for the panel was, how do you take care of yourself at this time of your life? What is it you do to help you get up and go to work every day, to deal with the issues around your families and your personal life, knowing that you're in such demand with the virus? It was interesting that that question was answered by so many people by saying gratitude. So many of the panelists said, when I get up in the morning, before I even get out of bed, one person said, I lay in bed and I just think about how much I have to be grateful for today. Others talk about experiences and people and health that they're grateful for. But the vast majority of them talked about sharing gratitude as a way to help them pick up, carry on, and do their work. So when Grace came up, it was Cinda's way of responding to that expression that people shared around having gratitude. I've always believed, and kind of still do, that grace is this undefinable, unmerited favor, that indescribable gift that comes simply as a gift of divinity, the universe. On this Father's Day, amidst parenting and homeschooling at home, during the time of physical distancing and limiting our social and work interactions, during the time of social unrest, and we're trying to determine how we can best help others, I invite you to discover grace in a practical way, an option to consider in finding our way through daily dilemmas. Cinda talked about grace in this acronym type of way And so I think it's something that we can adopt in our lives, be that as a dad, a spouse, a grandparent, someone who lives with another human being, someone trying to respond and do the right thing during the time of COVID-19, be that saying no when we're going and invitations to go out into the community if we don't feel physically safe, being able to have a good feeling or respond in a way that we feel appropriately when we're in community and we see folks are not following recommended medical guidelines, or be that just our own day-to-day struggle of finding ourselves limited and be at home and unable to go about and do the things we normally would want to do, be that at church or our workplace or with our grandchildren, or not being able to give a hug if we're a hugger. So many things that we can experience in our lives that we need a bit more of grace to endure. The acronym begins with G, gathering our intentions. The idea, as we begin this whole concept of beginning to focus and center and give thought to where we are in a particular instance of life, is first to gather our intentions. What is our focus? Just sometimes we can get so, I have found anyway, I can get so busy in the activities that I'm doing or thinking about so many things left undone that I must do that it's hard to focus on exactly where I am in the moment. So we begin with just focus, being present. Just breathe. Breathing in, breathing out. Finding a way to just center as we begin to think of our way through a particular issue or decision we're making. And then by breathing, begin thinking about what it is we're here, what's our intention, what are we doing. R is for recall our intention. Why are we doing this in the first place? If we're compelled to be at our state house to protest, why are we doing it in the first place? What is it deep in our soul that called us to participate? What called us to agree to sequester at home to keep ourselves and our neighbors safe? What is it that we're doing at work or in our personal lives with our children, or our grandchildren, or our neighbors that is fully intentional? Why did we decide to do this to begin with? I really do believe that sometimes revisiting that very issue is so critical. We can get so caught up in the process that we can forget the reason why. What was our original intention? The A in this acronym of GRACE is attuning first to ourselves, attuning to ourselves. How am I in this moment? I don't know about you, but sometimes I can be so caught up in tending others and taking care of others and or just doing the perfunctory day-to-day things that must be done, be that walking the dogs or preparing the meals ahead or getting the yard cleaned up or the house taken care of or deadlines met at our jobs. And sometimes we can forget about attuning to ourselves. How am I today? There have been times lately when I've taken that self-inventory and discussed that, gosh, I have some anticipatory anxiety going on. I'm kind of thinking ahead and worrying about tomorrow and not being present in the moment and finding myself worried without being able to really define what I'm worried about. Maybe you are finding yourself stressed for no explicable reason, or maybe angry, or maybe peaceful. There is significant value in attuning first to ourselves. Where am I today? What do I need to know about me? And then, of course, what am I bringing to this encounter? When we're attuned to ourselves, we can better understand what we bring to the encounter we're about to have or going to have by understanding our feelings, and thereby perhaps understanding our skills. Cinda also shared C in this acronym of GRACE. Consider what will best serve the situation. That's a big one. When I think about it, when I think about our COVID-19 medical community, so many of them talked about what they felt best served was to push and work 20-hour days. Others felt they needed to just withdraw and gain their emotional equilibrium and their spiritual center again. And today, you and I, be that as we're dealing with COVID-19, be that our deep shared pain around racial injustice in our nation and white supremacy, be that just our day-to-day stuff as spouses and parents and workers and bill payer and trying to get through from day to day. So it's okay to ask ourselves, what will best serve the situation? It may be participating in a protest. It may be a one-on-one conversation. It may be doing some research. It may be talking to a friend which we know would lift our spirits and help us to continue on with the effort. It may be to call our families together on this Father's Day and share our deep love for each other, as well as a commitment to make the world a fair and just place. So I leave that question with you. What will best serve the situation that you find yourself in? What's your answer? What's your conclusion? E, enacting. Move from considering what is best to actually doing it. It's so hard sometimes, especially if a lot is demanded of us and required of us, to know what to do is the best thing, and but to then to actually kind of do it. It's sometimes easier to not go against the grain or to go with the flow, even though we really feel that we should be doing something a bit differently. I invite you to move from considering what is best to actually doing it. And in doing it, the questions that come would be, is it respectful, this thing that I feel I ought to do or this response I ought to have? Is it a compassionate response? Is what I do and what I say, will it be out of the voice and heart of compassion? And is it just? When I act, when I move on this, considering what is best for me to do in a situation, and the decision to enact it, is that enacting a just cause? Do I feel justified in doing it? As our opening reading this morning, we gather as ordinary people, and sometimes we may not feel equal to the task before us, but this is what's been given us. On this Father's Day, you may feel like, I didn't really need one more event, one more difficulty in my life, but here I am. And as dads and as parents, we also are keenly aware that we have responsibilities that must be adhered to. At the same time, mending and taking care of ourselves. And this, I kind of think, is where the spiritual voice comes in. The opportunity of being present for ourselves, for those we love, staying centered and caring. I do submit this morning, that an attitude of gratitude and a bit of grace will help us fare well. Consider gratitude this morning. I invite you in your heart and mind to list the people, one by one, that you're grateful for, the gratitude that you have for the impact they have on your life. And then I invite you to offer grace to every person you come in contact with. And in so doing, my friends, I believe we can make a fairer and more just world. Amen. Closing words this morning are written by colleague Kendall Gibbons, entitled Only One Thing Is Required of Us. She wrote, "There is finally only one thing that's required of us, that is to take life whole. The sunlight and the shadows together, to live the life that is given us with courage and humor and the truth. We have such little moments of the vastness of time for all our wondering and loving. Therefore, let it be no half-heartedness. Rather, let the soul be ardent in its pain, in its yearning, in its praise. Then shall peace unfold our days, and glory shall not fade from our lives." Amen.
Our chalice extinguishing is titled As We Go Forward by Cheryl Block. As we go forward into this frightening, exhilarating, confusing, miraculous world, may we offer our comfort to the afflicted, our love to those who are so lonely, and our wish for all to be safe. And now our unison benediction. Let us go, remembering to praise, to live in the moment, to love mightily, and to bow to the mystery.